Everyone for being here. We're so honored that you joined us today. I am Aubrey Evans. I'm the Director of Professional Learning at Branch Ed. We're going to get started quickly. I know that everyone is eager to hear from our expert panelists. And so I'm going to begin by giving you a brief introduction to Branch Alliance for Educator Diversity. I'll share with you our mission statement. It is our mission to strengthen, grow, and lift up the impact of educator preparation programs, or EPPs, at minority-serving institutions as being central to efforts to shift the 20% of national representation of teachers of color to a much greater percentage of a diverse and highly qualified teaching force. In doing so, we can and will ensure that America's children receive the best education and support as possible. First, just a bit about this webinar series. Today, of course, is Reconceptualizing the Future of Teacher Preparation. Other webinars in this series are about reconceptualizing the future of field experiences, assessment, and partnerships. And at the end of today's webinar, I'll share a link where you can register for these events as well. This series came about because we recognize that we have an opportunity and a responsibility to take what we've learned from COVID about serving all students inclusively and equitably and using it to inform the future. And not just by adding on to what already exists, but what we want is transformation. And I'm guessing that you're all here because you want transformation too. So today's an important opportunity for us to come together as a community. And I want to invite you all to take a look at the other Zoom squares, the other people in the Zoom boxes. This is your community. The people in these Zoom squares are from EPPs and districts from MSIs and their communities all across the United States. You share with the other people in these Zoom boxes unique goals and values for educating future teachers. And our goal for this event is to inspire and motivate each other so that everyone leaves with the energy to make the change that we can within our sphere of influence. Today is, like I said, it's a reconceptualizing the future of teacher preparation. Today's panel makes up an experienced teacher, a superintendent, and a teacher education faculty member from an MSI EPP. And these are the key roles in teacher preparation. And before we get started, I'm gonna stop sharing here for just a moment. I wanna let everybody know that you can adjust your view of today's webinar. If you go to the top right of your screen and choose view, you can leave it on gallery view if you like, or you can choose speaker view if you wanna see whoever's speaking at the moment to appear big on the screen. So now I will pass it over to the Senior Vice President of Branch Alliance for Educator Diversity, Dr. Patricia Alvarez McHatton.
So good afternoon, everyone. It is so exciting to see all of you here. You are in for a treat. I have to tell you that our panelists, we met recently, and the conversation was so engaging, so energizing, that I really left there just feeling extremely, extremely hopeful. So we have three amazing folks. And so I want to start with Rodney. Rodney is a 20-year education veteran, and he was actually the 2019 National Teacher of the Year. So we've got an amazing educator who's going to be able to talk about his vision for teacher preparation. And then we have, and I'm going to just use first names, I hope everybody's okay with that. Chris is professor of bilingual education at Texas A&M International University, has a long, long history of preparing educators at the undergraduate and the graduate level. He was previously in California, University of California, Davis. And then we have one of my favorite people, and that is Art Gavassos. He is the superintendent of Harlingen Consolidated Independent School District. And I had an amazing, I used to be the dean at UTRGV, and I remember meeting Art, and he may talk about it. I don't want to go off on another tangent, but he's one of the most innovative superintendents that I have ever met in my entire life. So our process for today is really dialogue among the three panelists. I really want it to be a fluid conversation where what someone says kind of feeds the response from the others. We have some guiding questions, but it's not going to be a question one, question two, question three. It really is, let's start the conversation. And I want to start the conversation by acknowledging the fact that COVID definitely has provided us an opportunity to really see very deeply the inequities that exist in our society and in education. A lot of conversation is heard about getting back to the way things were, which was not a good place for very many kids or people, or of developing a new normal. And when I think of developing a new normal, it makes me think of developing another status quo. And so our talk today is really asking these three amazing individuals to talk about how do we reconceptualize teacher preparation? We believe education is the foundation of all professions. Teachers are leaders, and we have an immense responsibility in preparing our young people to take a role in society and make this a better place. So I'm gonna stop right there, and I'm gonna turn it over to my panelists. And I'm gonna ask for Art to kind of get us started to talk about his thinking about teacher preparation and where we need to be going. So Art.
Hey, thank you, Patty. And the check's in the mail. She was going to say that, and that I was a great guy. And so now I have to pay for that. So first of all, welcome everyone. And I know that everyone is busy and you're taking time from your schedule to join us today in the conversation. I think that the pandemic has actually allowed us to have what I call a reset button and really stop, look, and listen. And you know, I get excited at the opportunities. I know that it has been a very difficult year for children, for teachers, for administrators, and every parents. But it takes people like the people in the panel to go 30,000 foot view and look at what are the opportunities moving forward. There are things that happen in our journey in life that allow us to either embrace it and look for things to be different, or to simply just throw our hands up in the air with despair. And so I want to start the conversation by saying this: we have permission to think differently. And so I see the pandemic as giving us permission to think differently. And while some are managing the pandemic, we should be leading this conversation to do things different. I think Patty said that, you know, the COVID, the pandemic illuminated some things that we have known to be true for many years. I think Warren Buffett said during the economic crash that when the tide goes back, you're gonna find out who was swimming naked in the ocean. The tide went back. And we know that the inequities were illuminated. I call them the darkest corners of our programming. However, we would be remiss if we sit back and let the light go away again and we do nothing with it. And so I was told, can you join this panel? I said, if I'm gonna hang around with people that believe there's opportunities here, I'm all in. It takes our efforts to move forward and to really reconceptualize this space. I think that the sky is the limit. Think about this. When we went and we had pivoted to online learning, staff came to me and said, we have a digital gap. I said, wow, how'd you figure that one? No, I didn't say that. I said, yes, we do. But do you know that the digital gap was with the big people, not the little people? And so the problem with the little people and the challenge was access to Wi-Fi. It wasn't a digital gap, it was access. They knew how to use systems and computers and so forth. And so that's our challenge. Here's the new landscape. what are we going to do about it now? That's what motivates me and gets me up every morning, because we have another chance to do things different.
Thank you, Art. And I would like to encourage all of the participants, if you've got questions, to please put them in the chat. Ronnie, would you like to take the next, pick it up from Art. But you're muted.
Sorry, that's the quote of 2020. You're on mute.
I was going to tell you, Rodney, you were muted. Don't worry. I was going to not let you keep talking.
So I want to live where I never have to say, you're muted. I can't hear you. Can you hear me? I just want to not ever have to say that again. But anyway, go ahead, Rodney.
Yeah. I think what has happened, and you know, and it's very disappointing to me, is that when the pandemic first hit, everyone said, this is our opportunity. We can reimagine schooling. We can reimagine everything. But then what happened was they took a class, physical classroom, and tried to fit it into a screen. That's literally what most districts did. And with that came the, oh, wait a minute, we're finding out that poor kids don't have computers. Poor kids don't have access to Wi-Fi, you know, and these all sorts of things came up. And so it was just I think we're wasting an opportunity right now because we're pushing for the same old things. This is a time to think big. We really need to look at everything. Why isn't this working? You know, who are the kids that are doing well in virtual? And let's create a platform for them so that they can continue to prosper and do well in education. I think this is really a time for outside the box thinking, you know? And right now honestly, education is flush with cash, you know, because of the recent, you know, bills passed by Congress. And so let's use this money to tackle those inequities that existed for years and years and years. And if we can use this money, we can say, hey, this is what's necessary to fully fund our schools. You know, we can create, you know, online learning platforms for students who do well in a virtual environment. We can, you know, use this money to lower the student to teacher ratio. We can use this money to get more technology and resources for all students. I remember our district, in Richmond, we weren't a one-to-one technology district. Well, our kids didn't have technology. But then overnight, the community came together and said, we're going to make sure that every kid has a Chromebook. Every kid has a hotspot for Wi-Fi internet access. And that, to me, that was amazing that we came together to do this. So now let's come together again to reimagine what we can do in the future to serve our kids, because we know that some kids are not doing well in virtual learning. You know, not to get into the politics of that word, learning loss. It seems to be everybody's political fire now. But the reality is our kids are behind where they would normally be at this point. So we really need to do the work to make sure that our kids' skill level doesn't diminish, because we know that social emotional growth is important. We know that, we understand the social emotional growth. But at the same time, we have to acknowledge there's an academic part that our kids are missing out on. And so we need to go in to make sure all of our kids have access to the resources necessary to bring them back up. And right now, we really need to acknowledge that there's a great inequity when it comes to those resources. You know, it says, you know, like I love the quote about, you know, who's swimming in the ocean naked. I think that's great, you know, but the reality is, I think education knew that. We knew that for years. We knew that, kids. I get frustrated when people say, oh, where did this come from? You knew that existed the entire time, you know? And it's really important that we address that moving forward and make sure everyone has resources, everyone has access, and everyone has what's necessary to have a solid education.
So thank you so much, Rodney, because you touched on two things that came to mind as you were talking. One is that access to the internet is no longer a luxury. It is a necessity. And so we need to really, you know, as a society, from a policy perspective, need to start thinking about how do we help make that happen. The other piece that you touched on is the heavy narrative right now around learning loss. And I'm going to put a little star on that, because if we have time at the end, I'd like to come back to that, because I would say that our kids learned an awful lot in this past year. an awful lot. And while it may not have been math, you know, in the traditional sense or those types of things, I think there's some things that we need to be considering so that we meet our children where they are from an asset-based perspective. But that's I digress. I want to turn it over to Chris. Chris, talk to us, please, about your thoughts in this area.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for that, Patty. I'm going to talk a little bit about reconceptualizing the future of teacher education. I think the first, you know, both Art and Rodney talked about what's going on in schools and with children and access and those kinds of issues. And so I'm thinking about this as an opportunity really to rethink how teachers are prepared, the whole process that where we, you know, where we are now, for example, of, you know, how kids get in and that there's, you know, certainly there's lesson planning methods, there's reading courses, there's, you know, all these content area methods, foundations, policy, legal, those kinds of things. There's a lot of apprenticeship. There's learning theory that's presented and so forth. There's multicultural education, teaching English learners, and maybe a special ed. So those all get, and sort of, so that's, and then they get those courses and they may get some opportunities to internships. And then there's the final student teaching where they go out and are mentored for students. And that's pretty much the model that's used across the country to prepare. You know, I, having been in the field of teacher education for a long time, it's always bothered me that this is the same model that's been around for so long. And so I'd like to talk about some innovations in the way we prepare teachers. And I'm glad that there are some folks from California. I want to put a shout out to, here she is right there, Juliet. Yeah. Yay, a shout out to Juliet. Yeah. So, you know, one of the first things I would do is, you know, we just have to do these things is we have to scrap Bloom's taxonomy. You understand this was developed in the 1950s by an old white man who had never been spent a minute in classrooms, who was not bilingual, didn't live in multilingual or multicultural communities. And yet his ideas that permeate school. I think those are the kinds of things that we have to look for. And there are many other, I just picked the Bloom because that one still seems to be around, and whether we've changed it from a noun to a verb, it's still a misunderstanding of the language of ideas and the language of display in academic context. And so this means that we have to also, there's a great cognitive focus in teacher education when in fact we need to understand much more about social cultural issues in schools and in communities. And focus on the reorienting of teachers to understand what it means to be a listener of children. And some of the more recent work in a way, you know, and that Nelson Flores and Jonathan Rosa and Sami Alim have talked about the listener and what teachers hear when they hear children speak, their language of ideas and how they display their own knowledge. And we have to learn to interrogate the whiteness that's in our own listening system so that we understand how the language of minoritized youth and children and privileged children is taken up and listened to by teachers. So that would help us sort of rethink teacher ed. I also think things like skills, teaching skills, and looking at teaching as skills is a very old idea. I think we could move to sets of practices, ways of rehearsing, ways of enacting certain practices, engaging with students, eliciting, learning how to adjust the way that we interact with students and be really great listeners. And one of the ways that I would really redesign or rethink teacher education is in terms of four areas. So I'll share those now. Instead of this idea of, you know, like policy practices, methods, learning theory, and then, you know, some multicultural and stuff like that, EL, maybe bilingual, here's the one area would be living the life of questions and ideas. Another one would be living the life of science, art, and math. Another would be living the life of community membership, and then living the life of language and literacy. So, and that would include certainly bilingualism, multilingualism, biliteracy. And so that these ideas would be sort of overall, so we get kids to learn how to question, as opposed to constantly questioning them. We teach them how to question, and we use a lot of questions in the way that we interact and prepare, rehearse. Certainly STEAM and the encouragement of integrating art into science and mathematics, that community membership, that's part of all of the work that we do in teacher education, so that we get that sense of belonging, that teachers, we can no longer live in all white communities and then, you know, come into communities of color and then leave. We want to have this sense of community that we belong, and membership. We know the communities that we teach and things like that. And then language and literacy, to expand this idea of languaging and translanguaging and biliteracy. Those are very, very important, and how it is that we elicit and understand student languaging and thinking becomes really important. We want to do this, to be able to do this for English speakers as well as bilingual users of English, so that we have these, so that English is no longer just dominates everything that we do, because if we continue to do that, that puts us in a really an old way of thinking about what's core in our understanding of ideas and our ability to display those ideas just in one language, when much of the world, some two-thirds of the world is multilingual. So, I would be thinking about different ways of rehearsing, so if there's a great deal of rehearsing and enactment of novice teachers, so if they practice using questions and meaningful questions, and they learn how to listen to students and sort of even interrogate their own listening of students to address deficit perspectives. And
so, Chris, I'm gonna ask you to hold up 1 minute there, because you've certainly provided some provocative ideas of thinking about how to reconceptualize, the preparation part. Mm-hmm. So we prepare teachers to enter a system. Right. So, Dr. Cavazos, in what you've heard from Chris, mm-hmm. That we always talk about, there's this disconnect between, what we do in higher ed and what happens in schools. Talk to us about what you've heard from Chris, mm-hmm. and your thoughts as a school leader with regard to this.
So I do want to acknowledge that Chris brings forth a lot of great ideas and things to really ponder and to think about. What I'd like to weigh in on is when we talk about reconceptualizing something, mm-hmm. sometimes we approach it from the lens of barriers rather than what's possible, right? And we just are wired that way. We approach things from the sense of, well, what's going to get in the way of this reconceptualizing of anything? And so I think that as people in our profession, that we have to, one, embrace vulnerability, and two, embrace this idea that it's okay to think about what is the ideal and then work backwards. Because oftentimes what happens is we think of the ideal and we push it down the same systems. And what happens is there's no change. It just becomes an idea that has been, through the force of pushing it through the system, has been deteriorated, and we've negotiated out the idea. So think about that. The other is this, is that all of us, well, most of us, probably had never navigated a pandemic. Certainly, I had never navigated one for 18,000 students and 3,000 employees. But what I can tell you, and I think that we might capture something here, is we've been focused here in Harlingen the last 6 years in teaching kids what we call the 5 C's. So everything is weaved into the 5 C's of, we want kids to communicate effectively and be given opportunities to communicate. What a thought, right? Because when we were growing up, we were seen and not heard, right? Mm-hmm. Well, that's what my mother would tell us. But anyway, the second C is, we want kids to collaborate. Then we want them to think critically. We want them to be creative. and we want them to have commitment. And so think about that. If we are going to really look at teacher prep programs, mm-hmm. how can we center around those fundamental principles that if kids are equipped with them, they're able to navigate themselves through the journey of life? Because think about what it took for us to pivot back and forth to a virtual environment. Mm-hmm. We had to collaborate. We couldn't do it alone. We had to think critically. We had to be creative. We had to communicate. And by golly, we had to be committed mm-hmm. if we were going to bring all the children along. So rather than being very, what I would call very detail oriented, I think that we also have to kind of push it up a little bit and look at what are the skill sets that are needed. We call them, and we're not allowed to opt out of them, right? And so if you think of a child having those five skill sets, you can go back. Think of a teacher that teaches those skill sets. You can go back and say, what do we need to prop up? Mm-hmm. And look, reconceptualizing something, if we simply look at it from a deficit mindset mm-hmm. rather than a growth mindset, we're going to be having this conversation for a long time. Mm-hmm. And I tell people this, that we can talk till the cows come home. Mm-hmm. The concern is that the little people are waiting for the big people to get it right. We happen to be the big people today. And so what do we need to do to retrain and rethink the way we do business and be bold and lean into that rather than leaning away from it? Because the pressure to go back to normal, somehow people think that we were perfect back then, but we weren't. But the pressure to go back to normal, that pressure is really great. It's like a rubber band. You let it go and it's going to go back to where it was. I would challenge each and every one of us to keep stretching that rubber band and really look for ways to do things differently.
So Rodney, talk to us from the perspective of a teacher today and the past year and what we need to be thinking about, one, to make sure that when you enter the classroom as a novice teacher, you know, you're where you need to be, and consider what that might look like. Do we need to rethink that model of the minute you graduate, you're going to be an expert in the classroom? But more than that, you know, what are some of the needs of the teachers or desires of teachers given what we've experienced in this past year? You're muted again.
there you go.
thanks, Art. But that's a big question. And one, I mean, honestly, number one is pay. Let's be real. You know, we're not going to solve our current teacher crisis until we get more money, because it just simply does not make sense from an economic point of view for someone to go into education. Now, I remember there was a Wall Street Journal article about that, how when you think about the amount of debt that college-age people are taking on, and then when you get into the race of that and finding out how African-Americans are taking even more debt than other groups, it's not an attractive field. It just doesn't make sense financially to go into a job that pays $40,000 and you're taking $250,000 out and financial aid. You know, that just doesn't make sense economically. So if you really want to reimagine it, it starts by creating a national wage for teachers, plain and simple. You have to go there. Secondly, what we have to do is we have to make sure our teachers are prepared to teach in the environments that they were going into. I think we really need to start distinguishing as far as education major, if you want to work in an urban environment with urban issues and urban problems, well, then you should have a different set of courses than someone who wants to work in a different environment. Because we really need to prepare them for the students they will teach. That's number one. So if you want to teach, you know, primarily students of color, then you need to be well-versed in the pedagogy of teaching students of color. You need to be well-versed in who you are as a person and what you bring to the table and how that affects your relationships with your students, with your community, with everyone. You really need to understand who am I? Why do I want to teach here? And how do I have the requisite skill necessary to build the relationships in order to work here? Because honestly, I think right now what we do to some of our teachers is criminal. You know, we educate them for 4 years, you know, then throw them out and say, hey, you're a teacher now, you have a license, you know? But once you get into the classroom, you find out that there's a major disconnect between what I learned and what I'm facing every single day. And so I think we really need to look at our courses. We need to, number one, we need to look at the diversity of our schools of education. That's plain and simple. We talk about, oftentimes we talk about, you know, we know the 80-20, you know, in K-12 education, but that number is even higher in higher ed as far as who's teaching our students and who's preparing our students. I mean, our teachers to teach our students. So we really need to look at that diversity. We need to focus on culturally relevant pedagogy. We need to actually get back to the science of education sometimes, because I think sometimes in higher ed, we have people who have far too many philosophies on education. And philosophies of education are good. I mean, that's cool. Everybody has their own meaning, but we need to look at what works for kids. What scientifically do we know works for kids? And that needs to be what we teach students in schools of education. And I really, really think in the end, what it boils down to is the school of education preparing the students to teach in their environment. For one thing, I said, we know that there's a testing issue, you know, especially with minority candidates, as far as getting licensure. Well, the schools of education, what are your basic English and math classes looking like? Are they designed to help the student pass the praxis test? You know, and if not, what do we have to do to make sure that our students graduate knowing how to pass the test? Because me personally, you know, I really think it's criminal for a student to pay you $200,000 to prepare you for a field. And then when you go into it, you can't even pass the test to get to the field. You know, I don't look at that as a failure of the student. I look at that as the failure of the institution, because we took your money and said, we're going to prepare you for this, and you can't even pass the test to get into this. And so we really need to look at everything. And lastly, you need to just talk to them. I think far too often when people get into these positions, they want to tell you and make everything, oh, this is what works, rather than just asking the students in the schools of ed, hey, what works for you? You know, what do you need to be successful? You know, what harm are we doing you? Because a lot of our schools of ed are harming a lot of children to the point where I've had several conversations with people who said, if you thought my K, you know, especially African-Americans, like my K-12 experience was very toxic, but it's nothing compared to my higher ed experience. And so we need to make sure that we're creating welcoming environments. We're giving them the culturally relevant pedagogy that they need to go into the classroom. And so you can use the residency model is really, really good. But at the same time, I don't know a lot of people that can take a year off unpaid. So we really have to look at, we're talking about this money, let's get paid residencies for teachers. Let's do the things that we know works and invest in those heavily, you know? And then if something doesn't work, which in a lot of schools of ed are the way you're operating, toss it, chunk it. You know, let's make sure, like you said, we can't look at this from a point of view of we're limited. You know, if we really want to imagine it, we're going to say, hey, this is what we're going to do. Our plans aren't working, throw it out. Let's develop a brand new plan. Because in the end, an unprepared teacher only hurts the students that are in their classroom. And if our whole mindset is about student achievement, if we're not preparing teachers, then we're hurting students, we're hurting families, and we're limiting opportunities that they have in life.
So Rodney, I think that the other thing to add to your statement, which I think is very well said, is that we would not tolerate an ill-prepared pilot.
Yes.
We wouldn't tolerate an ill-prepared doctor.
Yes.
I remember my dad would end up in the hospital quite a bit, and the nurse would come in to draw blood. And his first question was, did you make an A in the course or did you make a C? What did you make? And I'd say, Dad, they're going to hurt you because you can't ask those questions. And he said, well, it's true. I want the one that made an aid. I don't want them looking for my vein 10 times. Here's the thing that I think, Rodney, what you said should resonate with everyone is the fact that we're never going to pay the teachers what they're worth. But when you think about the pandemic and what happened here, everybody realized the value of a teacher. And everybody began to look at, I mean, you had parents that wanted to drop off kids and the schools were closed. And you saw little articles and little, you know, jokes out there that where the parents said, you've lied all these years about my child. He is not a great kid. I have him now. I'm having him in my home, and I'm having to be the teacher. And so what I think that, you know, when you talk about residency programs, and so think about that as a concept. I think that if we're going to get closer to what the reality is when teachers are being prepared, then the last year needs to be in the schools, yeah, not at the colleges and universities.
Right.
And I think that the partnerships can be created as such that for the days that the teachers that are being prepared are not taking classes, that the ISDs pick them up as substitutes and give them a salary, and they can stay there every day and they can help the schools. We need all the help we can get. That's reconceptualizing what we do.
Yes.
We need to look at our current systems and the bureaucracies that we've created and be bold to blow them up and really unpack them. And are they really producing? Because you talk to the school districts and we're having to reteach and retool when new candidates come. And we can't afford to lose first, second, and third year teachers. We don't get do-overs. They get a set of kids as well. And so reconceptualizing the transition between college and university and into the school system, into the teaching profession. What if we overlay the last 2 years and we open our ISDs so that the university is now in our school buildings and seeing firsthand what they're going to be encountering and what the students are going to be encountering. And let our teachers, our mentor teachers, let our teachers be part of the solution, not at the tail end of the program, but throughout the program, because we can learn from the institution as well. And look, I'm going to say it again. The little people are waiting for us to get it right. We just have to be bold enough to rethink it.
Chris, you want to add anything?
No, not much. I mean, you know, the field of teacher education is just in such a need of sort of rethinking and restructuring, transforming, because it's just a system that I think, as artists pointed out, you know, the kids don't really sort of get into the classroom until that last semester, and that's where you have, and here in the state of Texas, they can't even do that unless they passed, three major tests. And so the set of things that we do during teaching during those preparation years is critical. And I think what Rodney said is very important, that these things have to be culturally relevant. They have to be tied to the communities in which they're going to teach. And so that goes from children's books, that goes from the kinds of issues and topics that are talked about in science and mathematics and social studies and art and music. That those kinds of things. I think that that's where we have an opportunity in teacher ed. And as Rodney said too, having been in teacher ed for many, many years, he's absolutely right. Most of the people that are in teacher ed are people who sort of came into that system and liked that system as a licensure system, as a very controlled system and things like that. And so to break that up is difficult, but this is an opportunity to break it up and really do things differently, see things differently, so that we prepare the best teachers so they want to stay in the schools, not just go in there and then leave for a wealthier school, which happens right in many, many cities.
Well, I remember when Patty was a dean of the College of Education here, and she came to me and she said, "What's your biggest struggle?" I said, "At home or at work?" Okay, I didn't say at home, but I said, "Where?" And she said, "At work." I said, "The biggest struggle is when I see first year teachers struggling." Mm-hmm. And she said, well, then let's fix it. I said, well, if you're going to be bold enough, let's fix it. And one of the things that we did is we did a year-long student teaching program. It's called Step Up. And the idea was that the candidate, teacher candidates, were going to see an entire year from start to finish. In the old system, they either saw how we closed down schools at the end of the year or how we opened them up.
Yeah.
And I will tell you that when we brought the students in and they were selected, who wants to be in the year-long step-up program, we hired a lot of them. And they outperformed first-year teachers that came from the traditional setting. Mm-hmm. Did it take a heavy lifting? Of course it did. Did it take a lot of work? Of course it did. But I will tell you that I'm a big believer of planning the work and then working the plan. And when you put someone in a system that has a year-long type of residency program or type of teacher prep program their last year, and it's a year-long, they see everything the teacher goes through for one entire year. What I told my board is that it was like if I was hiring a second-year experienced teacher, because they went through the entire year with one of the teachers. What an opportunity. And so what we can do with this conversation is this, is that there's possibilities. Yes. We just have to find the right people. And this is what I get a lot of times when we talk about innovation and transformation and so forth. They say, well, this law doesn't allow this, and this policy doesn't allow this, and this, the state policy or the federal policy and so forth. And I'm just a big believer that when you lay out all the rules and regulations, you find that where there's opportunities, our own institutions have created bureaucracies. And so I encourage you to go back and lay out all the rules of what you want to do different and look at what bureaucracy you created as an organization and a system that you have control over and be bold enough to unpack it and blow it up. Because it is in that space that the magic will happen. And look, if not us, then who? If not now, then when?
Yeah, and we just have to reach out. And like you said, I love the fact that you talked about that partnership. And one thing we're doing, you know, in Richmond is we're working on our partnerships right now. We're working with the colleges of ed and saying, hey, this is what we need to make our school system better and to make our teachers better. For example, you know, I see Dr. Walters on here from Virginia State. You know, he's running, you know, a teacher mentor program. But we got 25 of our guys into that program right now. And so when they come out, they will then, we also have a partnership with Virginia Commonwealth University where they're gonna mentor the male teachers of color that are in the VCU program so that when they come into education, they're already mentored by teachers in their environment. They've experienced their practicum, their student teaching, everything in our system so that when they graduate, we can hire them from day one and say, you know what you're doing. You know what you're signed up for. Because so far too often, we give teachers and we sign them up. It's like, yes, HR can check off a box. We got a math teacher who can go, you know, for our school. But is that teacher the right fit for your school? And when you get teachers and student teachers into the school systems, then they're able to acclimate to the environment. They're able to identify who they are and how they can help the environment. And so it's really, like you said, it requires thinking outside of the box so that we can really, really work on the problems at hand. You know, and like you said, the bureaucracy sometimes, you know, this is my first year in central office. And sometimes
you're part of it. You're part of the
bureaucracy. Yes, 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 I am part of the bureaucracy. But I find myself like, oh my gosh, this is just something so simple I want to get done. But the bureaucracy of getting it done, having to go through this person to get to that person to do this. And it's like, I could have just reached out and got it done myself, but I have to follow a protocol. And, you know, I really like the fact that you brought that up, how sometimes the bureaucracy gets in our way of doing what's best for students.
And so you know why bureaucracies exist, Rodney?
Why?
Because sometimes it's job dependent. It's somebody's job, that the person that created the bureaucracy for that system, that's why they exist as an employee, right? And so they're they're afraid to lose their job if you blow it up. So
just a thought. Yeah, but I'm really, really excited over some of the things we're doing. But at the same time, I'm also excited about what we can do as long as we work together and build these partnerships in and get these kids out of their college classroom sometimes and actually into the school building so that they can be better prepared for education.
Well, and Chris, I don't want to sound like that superintendent that thinks that if teacher prep would fix a problem, we wouldn't have any problems. So let me just say that and be very clear. I think that we have to be open to the change as well, right? Because oftentimes there's universities that want to try these new ideas and they hit a roadblock with the ISDs, right? And so we have to be open to the change as well, right? And what the research is saying. And so it takes us all to come to the table and leave our egos at the door and come in with grace and gratitude and with a helping heart and say, let's get it better. And we can do that. But we all play a part in it, right? Yes. All the organizations play a part in it if we're going to get better. Here's what I would, you know, encourage everyone to do is don't let this conversation just simply be a conversation today. We need to use our voice to continue to push the conversation and bring the people that are ready, they're able and willing to be different. Patty said, you know, the people that are gonna log on to this conversation are innovators, they're wanting to do things differently, they love change. So if you like South Texas, maybe I have a job for you. Okay, I'll let it go. Rodney, you wanna come work? We don't have a central office that creates bureaucracies over here, Rodney.
Nice to get everybody.
Chris, did you want to say something? Go ahead. No, go ahead, Chris.
Yeah, you know, I'm just saying, I know there are a lot of teacher educators in this audience today too, and you probably sense some frustration in that, you know, in the very nature of teacher education and who counts as teacher educators, and you know, how are the teacher mentors in that teacher education bucket and basket and whatnot, and so all of these things are really interesting topics to pursue, and I hope that we continue to pursue them. They're topics that have been going on for far too long, and to really shift how it is that we prepare teachers and work with school districts, and then have school districts also support the kinds of things that occur in teacher education once one of our students gets hired in that school is really critical, and we know that. So. Absolutely. I see there are a few questions here, so I'm going to just stop here and go ahead.
Oh, well, while Patty comes through the questions, I do want to say, Chris, that that I think that we have an opportunity for the ISDs to unpack our systems as well. And you know, as I sit here, I think about why don't we have a conversation of how we choose mentor teachers. Mm-hmm. Because we have had a framework for choosing mentor teachers for many years and thought all this time that we had it right, right? And maybe we do. But shouldn't we have a conversation around that? You know, and so every part of the journey for teacher prep all the way to being first year teacher and so forth and being teachers in the profession, we should be ready to unpack it and really think about how do we lift a better program, because we saw through the pandemic that disproportionately it was affecting the Hispanics, the African Americans, the different groups, and it's all about access and literacy, right? And so how do we get better as an organization? And so that's our challenge. So Patty, I think you're going through the questions. However, somebody say I'll work for free. That's the only one I get that. My God.
I was gonna say you're already recruiting.
Wait, is that Rodney that said he'd work for free? Rodney, come on, we'll take you.
No, I don't I don't work for I don't require a lot of money, but I don't work for free.
So that was Dr. Stacy Johnson, just so you know, she'll work for you. I'll read through. One of the challenges our graduates face is that we have a teacher-ed model that includes culturally sustaining pedagogy and invites them to develop critical, creative thinkers. However, when they enter the school system, the ideas they bring are often contrary to the culture of the school site. And so they shift into the culture that is already present. So Art, can you provide any commentary on that?
Yes, and so I think that speaks to, we have ideas, but we don't have the courage to identify the barriers and remove them as an organization. Maybe it's not that we don't have the courage, but maybe the appetite is not there. And because it's too much work. But look, time, as we learned through the pandemic, it's going by really quick and time flies. And we've lost a lot of loved ones throughout our country. And we only have a certain amount of time. So I don't want to get morbid, but I tell people, you know, our headstone has the day, the year we were born and the year we die. And that dash defines what we did on earth. So what is your dash going to be, right? And so that should be a motivating factor, because somebody did it for us. It's time for we do it for our children. I will say this, that it is very hard to change an existing culture. But even in a deep-rooted, entrenched culture, you have individuals there that are willing to take a chance and do the right thing and really push and lean into our fears. Grab those individuals and champion the work. The pandemic has given us the permission to think differently.
So some of the other discussion points have to do with being careful in selecting the best educators to serve as mentors. And I think you all talked a little bit about that, the importance of having conversations around that. And then the other has to do with, you know, the idea of culturally responsive integration. In practice, a lot of the individuals who profess that they are not necessarily culturally responsive at all. And so somehow we have to move from theory and flowery words to actual practice. And I think an important point to that is that, you know, we're always in a state of becoming. And when it comes to working, you know, from a culturally sustaining responsive lens, you never arrive. I mean, you just don't. So the minute you think you're there, you're not. So I think we all need to understand that we're all a work in progress, and that we need to continue the work and further our own development if we're going to really make some changes. So we're getting close to our time, but so folks, please continue to add the questions. So I guess a couple of things come to mind. One is, two things came to mind. One is, you know, we're talking about reconceptualizing and rethinking teacher prep. And I sometimes think, well, you know, it's hard to imagine that which you have not seen. So how do we position ourselves in a space where we allow our mind to really, you know, unshackle, you know, our thinking so that we really can begin to think about things differently? I think that's one piece. And then and kind of like a question to all three of you in kind of closing. And the last one is, how do we bring people along that journey? Like, how can we get people to understand that, yes, we can. Yes, we can. How do we do that?
So I'll take a stab at it, Patty. I think that in every organization and in every school building, there are individuals who are shining stars. There are individuals who are ready to rethink the way we do business. I think it starts with putting them through an exercise that, and I did this several times. I've done it over time. But I sit with the people who are in the organization. And one of the questions that I say is, well, my son would tell me what I need to do as a superintendent. He was in the school system. And I said, when you become the superintendent, you'll fix all the problems I created. But anyway, one of the things that we want to tell the individuals is, if you were sitting in my chair, what are two things you would stop doing today? And what are two things you would start doing and why? Just think about that. Because that takes them out of their own perspective and puts them in a different space. And just say, what would you stop doing today? Because what you will find and what I have found over time is that within our own organizations and institutions, we have a lot of the answers. What we don't have is the courage and the understanding how to change systems and structures. It's that part of the work that's a heavy lifting. And so that's what I would you know, say to that question, Patty, is have the conversation and sit there and bring teachers. Do you know that we name a teacher of the year for every one of our schools every year? And the following year, they become our thought partners, and we call it Teacher of the Year Challenge for the following year. And they are our thought partners, and they sit with the administration and address our very complex issues that we have not gotten right. And we get it from their lens, and it is incredible what they've pushed out in the last 4 years, because they were given the opportunity, we created the environment where they could think freely and really help us be part of that organization and solve the problems. And think about it, 30 teachers from all over the district coming together, solving a complex problem for their district and being part of the solution. It empowers them, and they also become the voice of the solution. So there are ways in which you can start those conversations at a small scale, big scale. It's just really studying how you want to proceed.
So I want to give Rodney and Chris a chance to also weigh in, and then I'll turn it over to Aubrey. Anything you want to add, Rodney?
I think one thing we have to do is we have to leverage families and communities. You know, far too often in education, we tell our families and our students what we're going to do, rather than bringing them to the table and saying, hey, what works for you? You know, a friend of my office says parent is the biggest expert on how their kids learn. And so I really think we need to leverage that partnership to create more opportunities, to create more programs that fit the needs of our parents, of our communities. And I really think we need to make sure that we're preparing teachers to, like I said earlier, understand who you are. That's the number one thing as a teacher I think you have to do. Understand who you are as a person and what you bring to the table, what biases, what issues, what implicit and explicit biases you bring to the table that get in the way of you serving the needs of the students and the community you serve. Because once you understand who you are, then it's much easier to work with a different community. You know, far too often we say, hey, I need to learn about my students. No, you don't. You need to learn about yourself and how you can relate to those students. And so it's really, 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 really important that we start putting the onus on teachers and on systems, rather than just saying you have to learn the community, you know, because that sort of puts it on the kid like something's wrong with me that you have to come learn who I am and my community. No, something's wrong with the teachers, the system, if you don't understand what's wrong with the community. And so I really think we need to leverage those partnerships. And I think from a higher ed point of view, you can leverage the partnerships to understand your community. And even from, you know, the school system itself, you know, you need to partner with higher ed. Everybody needs to work together. Far too many independent ideas and independent thoughts, because the reality is when you push change, there are going to be people to push back. People are going to push back. People don't like change. But if you have a consistent goals, if you're united as a community, then you can get through the change that you see necessary, because in the end, everybody's at the table and everybody understands that student achievement and student success is our number one goal. So just make sure that everybody's at the table, everybody has a voice, because you are much stronger together as a community than as one entity trying to make decisions for a community.
Thank you. Chris,
Oh boy, I'll be really fast. I'm glad that Rodney brought that up and Art as well. I mean, living the life of community membership is one of the goals that we would have here at TAMIU, to get that sense of who we are and how we think about the community, what we have been told about communities like this and how we engage with the community and parents and things like that. So those are very important. Of course, living the life of questions and ideas, how it is that we have a very inquiry stance in the way that we come to teaching, so that we're constantly asking questions about what we're being taught and things like that. So I hope that we have an opportunity to really, as we come through this, to make some transformations in teacher education, and really listen much more to communities, families, children, parents, and those kinds of things, as we understand, be better listeners, and also understand that our listening lens is often a white gaze, and we have to confront that and really make those fundamental changes in who we are and what we can do. So I'll stop with that. Thank you, Patty.
Thank you. Thank you so much. You just kind of summarized it and brought it all home, Chris. Thank you so much. So I think these three individuals are absolutely amazing. So thank you all. But I'm going to turn it over to Aubrey, because otherwise she's going to get mad at me because she needs a few minutes to share some information. So.
Yeah, thank you, everyone. I do feel inspired and moved, and this was incredible. I want to show everyone our events page where you can register for our future events before I let you go. This is a little bit like a secret handshake, because you are special. Our community and Branch Ed is special to us. So our events page is actually not navigable from our main website. So I put the link in the chat for our events where you can register. And if just a little bit of a hint, if you go to our website and put /events, that'll take you there too. So these are upcoming events where you can register here directly. Our next Nuts and Bolts series is on May 5th, same time next month, and it is on reconceptualizing the future of field experiences. And if you ever need help finding that website again, just email me or Patty or anyone at Branch Ed, and we can take you there. And we would love your feedback. Our goal is to serve you, and your feedback helps us do that. So I'm going to put a link to a survey in the chat. And a couple people asked if the recording will be available. Yes, we will email the recording and also the survey link as well after the event. Thank you, everybody, for being here. Thank you so much.